My iron won't go up, even though I'm supplementing. Hi, I'm Chris Masterjohn, and I have a PhD in nutritional sciences. I am not a medical doctor, and nothing contained in this episode may be construed as medical or nutritional advice of any kind, or a substitute, therefore. This episode is meant purely as scientific education. If you wish to act on any ideas presented in this episode, please consult your physician first, and never take anything herein as a reason to contradict medical advice. With that said, enjoy the episode.
My question is, I have a couple of friends who appear to have iron deficiency anemia and have been advised by their doctors to take large doses of iron and still have trouble getting their iron levels up. And I myself have also been having an issue, probably because I've had to have a bunch of blood draws getting my iron levels up. And my question is that I know that you've written that for zinc, that the body can only absorb about 7 milligrams at a time. And is there a similar limitation for iron that I should be spacing out my doses, or can the body absorb larger amounts at once? I also am concerned that there might be other complicating medical issues that I need to watch out for, whether for me or my friends, and trying to get our iron levels up.
Off the top of my head, I'm not sure whether there is a similar absorption cap for iron. And I'm trying to think, there was, I'm not sure, but I do think that the general assumption should be that you will absorb more of anything if you're going to spread it out. So just on that basis, if you're taking, you know, more than like 18 milligrams or something at a time, I would spread that out over multiple meals. I think you'll get a better results. Mm-hmm. But I wouldn't really suspect that that would be the primary issue with getting iron levels up if you're supplementing with that dose or higher. So I would be more suspicious that, well, if with blood loss, I mean, that can be an obvious output of iron. And so if volume of blood loss is not a good explanation for needing a high amount of iron, then I would go to other things involved in iron absorption. The top things that I would think of would be riboflavin and copper. And plus inhibitors of iron absorption. So generally speaking, plant foods are strong iron absorption inhibitors. I mean, there's some complicating factors to that. There are like vitamin C in certain plant foods will help with iron absorption, and organic acids. As I just mentioned in the previous question, generally potassium is a good index of the organic acid content of food. And so generally, if you look at like the potassium, generally you're going to have organic acids that promote iron absorption in proportion to the amount of potassium in the vegetables that you eat. Although it's also the case that polyphenols will tend to correlate, and polyphenols inhibit iron absorption. So I'm kind of the opinion that you shouldn't eat plant foods at the meal that you're trying to get your iron in if you have trouble getting your iron up.
That you shouldn't eat?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I would take the iron supplement with a carnivore meal. If you want to eat plant foods, eat them at some other point in the day. I think you get better results from taking your iron supplement with a meal of steak and clams. And, you know, maybe supplement with a little vitamin C and take a copper and riboflavin supplement. I think that would work a lot better than, you know, spreading iron supplements across 3 plant-rich meals a day.
So you're saying, like, because tofu is somewhat high in iron, that would not be a good source?
I wouldn't
source.
Rely on tofu for iron, no.
Okay.
So generally, the biggest inhibitors of iron absorption are phytate and polyphenols and plant protein. And there are no plants that are high in iron that are not high in those factors. And if you look at iron status globally, generally iron status is good when there's more animal foods and less plant foods in the diet, and iron status is bad when there's less animal foods and more plant foods in the diet. So, you know, if you're, I'll give you a personal anecdote. So a couple of years ago, I am homozygous for the H63D allele in hemochromatosis, which is the less severe form of hemochromatosis. But my problem is that I'll get iron overload if I'm not donating my blood. So I went like 2 years without donating blood, eating 10 ounces of red meat every day and eating lots and lots of vegetables. And when I did a dietary analysis, my vegetables were giving me 45 milligrams of iron a day, and my steak was giving me like 8 milligrams of iron a day. And yet, my blood results showed that my iron wasn't going up, even though I wasn't donating blood. So basically, the vegetables that had 45 milligrams of iron in them were stopping me from absorbing iron from the steak and were basically giving, you know, making my iron levels fine. So if I had the opposite problem of anemia, iron deficiency anemia, I wouldn't want to eat that diet because it wouldn't be effective at raising my iron levels despite having 50 or 60 milligrams of iron in it.
Wow.
Now, I'm not saying no one can have good iron status on a plant-based diet. I'm saying if you're eating a plant-based diet and your iron is deficient and it's not going anywhere, even if you supplement, then I wouldn't spend time wondering why. Are you a vegan?
No, I'm not. I was mostly vegetarian, but I've had to stop that due to various deficiencies. So,
okay. So, yeah. It obviously would have to modify the approach if you were vegan because eating animal protein wouldn't be an option. But if you're not vegan, then I would just take the iron supplement with, you know, eat one meal a day that's carnivore. And it doesn't have to be meat, it could be egg yolk. But should keep in mind that even within eggs, egg white protein inhibits iron absorption and egg yolk protein promotes iron absorption. So you really should throw out the whites. But, you know, eat egg yolks, meat, or shellfish, take an iron supplement, and just eat all your plant foods at a different meal. I would think that, and you can take the iron supplement, take an 18 milligram iron bisglycinate supplement or something like that. I would expect that would be more effective than increasing the dose of iron or than, trying to chop the iron up into smaller doses that are taken more frequently.
So if you do eat a meal that has phytates in it, are you saying you can't compensate with like extra supplement of iron, or I'm also having issue with zinc? So,
right. So zinc and iron are the two nutrients that are overwhelmingly, their status is correlated with the animal to plant ratio in the diet, period. All you need to do to get good iron and zinc status is eat less plants and more animal foods. That's really clear for globally. Just iron and zinc are the two most prevalent mineral deficiencies on Earth. And on a population level, they're extremely correlated with the plant to animal ratio of the diet. Anywhere where there's endemic iron or zinc deficiency, it's in populations that mostly eat plants. The difference between zinc and iron is that zinc is much more specifically inhibited by phytate. Whereas iron is sort of just broadly inhibited by plants. Almost everything that's in plants inhibits iron absorption. except vitamin C and organic acids. Mm-hmm. So if you only had a zinc deficiency, then I would say, you know, just work on getting your zinc in without phytate. But if you have a combined iron and zinc deficiency, then you can just sort of follow the iron rules for zinc, because you don't want to take your zinc at a phytate rich meal. But you already have that issue with iron, right? So the meal that you take iron at is the meal you would want to take zinc at.
But don't they compete for absorption?
No, I mean, there's, I believe I was asked about a study on this. That might've been the study I'm thinking of. They're definitely not going to compete for absorption, in over the long term in any meaningful way. And I think that's evident from just, you know, look at where you would get zinc and iron in foods. If you exclude the plant foods with the clear inhibitors, zinc is richest in oysters, beef and cheese, red meat and cheese, and iron is richest in red meat and clams, basically. There's not really, I mean, how would you eat to get iron or zinc if you couldn't eat iron and zinc at the same time? There wouldn't be anyone in the world who would have enough iron and zinc. So if you're concerned about that, then I would just take the zinc on an empty stomach or with the minimal amount of phytate-free food or drink that prevents nausea if that's an issue. Generally, if you take 15 milligrams, 1.5 milligrams, most people don't get nauseated from that, but some people do. If you do have some nausea from it, you can usually get rid of that with food. So just a minimal amount of phytate-free food or drink with the zinc or on an empty stomach. And then an hour later, eat your iron with your carnivore meal. That's probably the best way to do that. But the concern about getting zinc and iron at the same meal is trivial, very trivial compared to the concern about eating either of those with a phytate-rich plant meal. In theory, you can compensate by consuming enough zinc. The problem is that no one really knows what amount of zinc that is. So like the RDA assumes that if you're a vegetarian, you're going to need 50% more zinc than the RDA says because of the inhibitory effect of phytate. But there's also computer modeling out there that suggested that you might need some much more. I forget what they concluded, but I think they concluded that with a very high phytate diet, you might need like 100 milligrams of zinc or something to compensate for it. The reality is that until we have very detailed and elegant studies testing the zinc requirement on different levels of phytate, I don't see the point of trying to figure out. I think you're going to get results much faster if you just take the zinc and iron at a phytate-free carnivore-ish meal than by trying to figure out how to titrate up your zinc and iron. You open the question with you and some of your friends are having trouble getting your iron levels up and you're taking the supplements, not doing anything. And so you can try that. I just think that you're going to get more. I think you're just going to spend a lot more time wondering why the dose still isn't enough, rather than getting results quicker. And I'm not saying that everyone who has an iron or zinc deficiency needs to forever eat one carnivore meal a day with zinc and iron supplements. I'm just saying as a short-term intervention to move the zinc and iron up to levels that you can, you know, get them up quickly and then move into maintenance, you know, during that period of time where I was trying to get them up rather quickly, I would be focusing on just maximizing absorption by taking them without any absorption inhibitors. And then when you get your levels up, then you can, shift into a maintenance mode where you're focusing on things that better match your desires in terms of how you want to arrange your diet. So that's how I would view that.
Thank you. One last related thing is, how long should I expect it to take to be able to replete my levels?
That's kind of dependent on how deficient they are and how effective what you're doing is. But I would think they would move, your level should move in at least 4 weeks, and you should get significant results in at least 12 weeks. But that, you know, that also sort of depends on where you are, as well. But I think if you retest in 4 weeks of doing a certain approach, I think you can conclude whether it's doing anything at all or not, based on the results at 4 weeks. I don't think you're going to have fixed the whole thing in most cases, but if you see no difference, then you probably need to, after 4 weeks, and you probably need to change your approach to something a little bit more intense.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much. Switching it up.
Okay, great. It was great talking to you, Margaret. Thank you.
This episode was part of a Q&A for members of the CMJ MasterPass, where I hold monthly private Zoom Q&As for my members. The MasterPass also serves as a buyer's club with exclusive and massive discounts on your favorite premium foods and health products, including pasture-raised and wild meat and seafood, supplements, sleep accessories, water filters, phototherapy devices, and much more. If you'd like to participate in these Q&As, you can join the MasterPass at chrismasterjohnphd.com/masterpass and use the code Q&A, spelled Q-A-N-D-A, Q&A, for 10% lifetime discount. I am currently working full-time on finishing my first book, Vitamins and Minerals 101, How to Get the Nutrients You Need on Any Diet. I will let you know when I have a release date. In the meantime, you can pre-order the book at chrismasterjohnphd.com/book. Testing Nutritional Status, The Ultimate Cheat Sheet, has been newly released as version 1.3. This is my comprehensive system for managing nutritional status with lab tests, dietary analysis, and comprehensive intake of your signs and symptoms. The new version has a comprehensive guide to interpreting the Genova methylation panel. You can pick up your copy at chrismasterjohnphd.com/cheat sheet. In my consulting, I am neither a medical practitioner nor a coach. I serve as your data analyst and your strategist. I teach you scientific principles of health and wellness, help you analyze your data, and help brainstorm actionable strategies. You can sign up for a consultation at chrismasterjohnphd.com/consultations. Please consider supporting my work at no extra cost to you by visiting my support page and making a purchase with one of my affiliate links. Some of my most popular affiliates are also listed in the description of this video with links that will give me credit for your purchase. I will try to respond to comments when I can, but my presence will be intermittent while I'm finishing my book. I hope you enjoyed this, and I will see you in the next episode.